Good morning. Joy, joy, joy. Good morning to everyone in the sanctuary, and good morning to all our friends on Zoom. So my name is Ruth Hendry, and I am your worship associate this morning, and I'm happy to welcome you to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Washington Crossing. Hello, let's start over. Good morning. I'm sorry, I was a member of the Unitarian Universalist Church at Washington Crossing for 30 years. So good morning and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Delaware County in Media. My name is Ruth Hendry and I'm your worship associate this morning. I offer a heartfelt welcome to each of you, member, friend, and first-time visitor. I am glad that you put aside whatever you had to do this morning and whatever awaits you later to join us for worship this morning. This morning's service is a rebroadcast of last week's Sunday morning service at the General Assembly of the Unitarian Universalist Association in Portland, Oregon. The program states, "The last few years have not been easy, including in our local congregations. Whole swaths of members have simply stopped coming. COVID is confusing and polarizing. Many ministers have joined the Great Resignation, and Pew studies and friends alike have pronounced the end of the local church. In this moment, when so many of us might be wondering if we should just give up and relent, now's the time instead to double down on our commitment to the local church, this unique community that saves us and also breaks our heart. Often much more of the latter than we would like to admit. In the midst of our culture of death, the church is a place of life, or it is as long as we are willing to bring our own lives to it. Join us for a morning of celebration, witness, and future visioning for the already and not yet power of the local Unitarian Universalist Church, to which I say amen. And there are folks on Zoom, so we're actually a very large body today. And I'm so glad that you're here in person because the local church is so important. The worship leaders are Reverend Gretchen Haley from Fort Collins, Colorado, Reverend Sherry Halliday Kwan from Rochester, New York, and Reverend Sean Neal Barron, also from Fort Collins. Leah Morris, Adam Pod, Joseph and Amy Santos Leon from Manila, the Philippines, Allison Craig with the General Assembly Choir. Before we begin our service, I have a few housekeeping reminders. If this is your first time visiting us, please check in on our church website so we have a way to keep in touch with you. The second is that this service runs longer than our normal service. I encourage you to make yourself comfortable and be present in the moment. If you must leave early, please just leave and we will see you next week. And we understand. And if you need to go to the restroom, there's one at the end of the hall down there. Right? You may, during the beginning of the sermon, the large screen projection is overlaid on the face of the human being. And you might find that as annoying as I did. However, it goes away, and there's nothing we can do about it. So I just wanted to let you know that. I want to thank Don Sloat and Rob Sartain, our tech gurus, Joe Miller from our hospitality team, and our Zoom host online. I'm not sure who that is today, sadly. At the end of our service, please join us for our virtual coffee hour. To join the breakout room at the end of the service. So without further ado, it's 90 minutes, give or take.
Come, come now across platforms and practices.
To declare with joy our resilience.
To proclaim on purpose.
We have survived the pandemics of our time.
We have survived. We are surviving.
We have pivoted and we have planned.
And then replanned.
And then thrown all plans to the wind.
In this circle, we will say without shame,
some days we lost our way.
And some days we lost our passwords.
And we have not always been our best selves.
We are learning.
Not always quickly.
To regroup and remember, perfection was never the point.
Amen.
We are here because we long to try again.
To promise with people to be partners.
In this long haul work of loving.
And becoming.
Even while we grieve also the cost.
Which is not small and lingers in our hearts.
And turns only sometimes into rage.
Here, let your body tell the truth.
Shake free the stories that live in your skin.
Breathe in your beauty. And breathe out your burdens.
Breathe in our beauty. And breathe out our burdens.
Be here with it all, with all of us.
In the freedom of this new day.
The storm is passing over.
The sun is breaking through.
And this new day, it dawns for us all.
Come, let us worship together.
Thank you. Mapagpalayang umaga sa lahat, a liberating morning to us all. I'm Amy Santos Lyons. I was leaning into the UU faith as I met Joseph and happily found out that there was a congregation in the Philippines where I was raised.
And I'm Joseph Santos Lyons, and I was raised in the Unitarian Universalist Church.
I'm Micaela. I am being raised UU in the Philippines, but there are no churches nearby that we can go to.
I'm Iara. I am a Unitarian Universalist, but I'm not religious.
We are a diverse Unitarian Universalist family, each one on a different pathway, crisscrossing, diverging, converging, and reemerging. Each of us building our own local communities, organizing with our own people, trading notes, learning lessons, giving and receiving support, ultimately weaving and widening our beautiful circles of community.
We are surviving, and the last 2 years have been rough. We are reminded there is not one story of the pandemic. Our family was locked down in the Philippines under the police state instituted by the murderous, fascist, and incompetent President Duterte, who has now been replaced by the fascist and incompetent son of the dictator, Marcos Jr.
In those last 2 years, we lost one of my mother's best friends, Tita Susan Kimpo.
My dad's longtime co-conspirator in the UU Church, Alandria Will.
We didn't have the energy to think about community organizing.
We went through multiple shocks on top of shocks, the meaning of life blurred, and we grasped from our new home in Manila.
The pandemic revealed the hard truths of our society. The brutal structural and economic inequalities. Arundhati Roy called the lockdown a great chemical experiment that suddenly illuminated hidden things. While wealthy and middle-class communities enclosed themselves in gated colonies with access to deliveries, working-class and poor people experienced the inhumanity of our broken healthcare system.
We felt uncertainty and scarcity. We experienced rich countries in the West hoarding vaccines and medical knowledge. We struggled with misinformation and vaccine hesitancy. We were overwhelmed with calls for mutual aid, the needs of our own children and family, the tending to sick loved ones, and long periods of isolation and lockdown.
When all else fails, when all feels lost, there is a fellowship. Kindred spirits who are with you on your journey, however terrible. To find and be found with other people, giving what you can, taking what you need, there is a beauty there. For we remember that the first sign of human community was the mending of a broken bone.
When all the odds are not in our favor, and when the powerful act with impunity, there is always refuge, a sanctuary, a place to gather our strength, to be among the people who share our lives and who move towards the same horizon, community, a metaphorical place to soak our weary bones and body and let its waters replenish you. When hope was seemingly lost, I often reminded myself that I am a Unitarian Universalist. We stand witness to the broken world, to the vulnerable and to the voiceless. Gathering strangers and helping build a family, build community, build hope and power.
Community is ever evolving and can take many shapes.
Sometimes community is my barcada of friends, or it's a book club my father organized with religious professionals of color, or it's my mother convening the neighbors to make signs for protests.
In an increasingly complex and socially distancing and unjust world, we try many ways to find each other and offer solidarity, strategy, and support.
Ultimately weaving and widening our beloved communities.
Together we light this chalice.
If you can sing, I invite you to sing with us. If you can't sing, I invite you to sing with us. Either way, I invite you to move your body, to sway, to rock with the music.
Flying through space at 1,000 miles an hour, and still the earth holds us steady. I am told that when you have been carrying a baby outside of your body, holding a beloved and rocking them, you sometimes find yourself rocking all on your own, being rocked, caring for creation. I know a preacher who sways back and forth on the street corner or in the pulpit, rocking, being rocked, loving into being our co-creation. Spirit of life, divine mother of many names and one abundant love, we come to this moment from many places. Thousands of stories, thousands of storms flying 1,000 miles an hour on this one rock. We come full of ideas and excitement, new connections. We come with rage, fear, loneliness. We come with something to give. We come needing something, but not even sure of what that is. And even if we're overwhelmed by all of this, we're so grateful to be here. So grateful to be alive, grateful for the people who surround us. We give thanks for this moment. Let us rest here in your embrace. Ancestors, hold us here in this sacred gathering, your presence felt or longed for. Now and always, you remind us that while our bodies sway, we are connected in so many ways. ancestors. There are so many more of you than when we last gathered in body together. Ancestors, hold us. Let us hold you. Let us call you by name. I invite you to share aloud. Let us speak out loud in the chat, those who have passed and who are still with us. Kim Hampton, Gene Pupke, John Newhall, Matthew Taylor, Kelly McConnell, Alandria Williams, Hope Johnson. Ancestors, hold us, strengthen us. We grieve, we remember, and we give thanks for all who have come before. Like those who have come before, like the person I was last year, like the you of 1 hour from now, and the community that we used to be. We are all always changing. The ancestors called into this place, they were far from perfect. And even with the head start on their mistakes, we have not learned all the lessons. As people and communities, our courage flickers and falters. Here in the witness of community, we open to the truth that we do not always get it right. We call to mind the moments when we have failed to live out of our deepest values, when we've been mean-spirited or selfish, when we've been complicit, sometimes for survival, with white supremacy and systems of oppression. When we have done harm, even unknowingly, to our beloveds. Here in the witness of community, we know and name that there are those among us who have been hurt. We have not and are not always treated right. Many of us carry invisible wounds from our communities, our ancestors, our churches, our beloveds, and our faith. May the terms of forgiveness be ours. May our shared experience be a blessing. May we find new pathways to healing. For we contain multitudes. Growth is a messy affair, imperfect and unceasing. May rest offer the chance to form new connections, our brains and our relationships and our stories nurtured in darkness. We open to this day. Loving embrace, May we find an ease that tempts us not into shutting out the world, not denying it, not fixing it all by ourselves. Lead us to rest, to be held, to hold, to not know, to try anyway, to love, to take delight, to rise again and again, to co-create the world. May we find this place and this people of welcome and belonging. May we be that place and those people.
My friends used to ask me, why do you go to church? After I became a minister, they stopped asking. But the thing is, I never did. Why do I go to church? Church is the place that has broken my heart more times than any other. The beauty of its potential obscured by the labor of reality that churches are human, not utopian endeavors. Every church I have ever been a part of has never been exactly who they proclaimed to be, never been exactly who I wanted them to be, never been exactly who I needed them to be. Why do I go to church? I have witnessed professionals violating the trust granted to them, cloaking their deceit in the garb of spiritual language, congregational bullies allowed to rampage in the name of nice or freedom of belief, causing beloved people to step away, the pain too great to continue. I have witnessed trauma like a puppeteer pulling the strings, compelling us to play out old stories again and again and again and again. Why do I go to church? Why do we keep going? The longer you stay in, the more grief you accumulate. The grief of the people who left the faith, left your church to attend another or not, or simply left life. And even as the joy of new people arriving rises, you look around sometimes and realize that you don't recognize anyone anymore, and you wonder if that must mean it's time for you to leave. Why church? For it will be true that the church you join will not be the same church you leave, changed by your presence, changed by the presence of every other. That's the beauty, that's the magic, but it's also the heartbreak. There is so much that changes in the life of a church. The musical stylings of generations come and go. The language and words of reverence shift. We decenter what was once assumed to be our essence to reveal the liberatory power within. We constantly evolve and revolve around our core, that determination of love to break forth, that question. Why, church, does not have one answer, not one that can endure a lifetime, not one answer the same for each of us, our answers like stars forming new constellations, guiding us in every season of life, pointing us towards a simple impulse. Why, church? Well, simply because, church. I call it the casserole reflex. That when the church hears the news of the diagnosis or the accident or looming crisis of death, divorce, or disaster, somehow, even before they realize it, the casserole dish is in the oven and instinct to care just baked in. The same reflex taught me that when certain events happen, you don't call, you don't text, you go. Awkwardly, sure. Uncomfortably, of course, but you show up. Why? Because church. It's the feeling we get gathered for imperfect worship, a collection of friends, strangers, united by an almost indescribable promise that answers a question coded deep within us, the need to belong, to be reminded of that belongingness, the full embrace that conveys the truth that all the parts of you, the questioning parts, the doubting parts, the cynical parts, the hurt parts, are not only welcome, but they are necessary here, that if universal salvation is true for all of us, it must be true for all parts of us too. Amen? Why? Because church. It's a temporal embrace, an embrace with one arm ancestral and the other futuristic, converging together, a complex embrace, holding as much pain as potential, a belonging that grounds us and orients us into time itself, a belonging that says that you, yes, you, are part of an unfolding story, the end of which has not been written, and here we will face it not alone or unequipped, unprepared or unprotected, for we have stories and practices, rituals and music and ancestors and baggage. And you don't need to strike out on your own. You don't need to make it up all by yourself and look around. You don't have to do it alone either, for you have a people. Why? Because church. For a society that tells me that I need to be self-made, I need church that tells me I exist because we are. For if the choice were independence or interdependence, there is no question that I would choose that gnarlier path if we can go together. And it is church more often than any other place that never lets me forget it. Why? Because church. It's the beauty. You know it, of a child dedicated in the arms of its family. It's the 85-year-olds who, when the pandemic hit, became Zoom experts overnight and then taught others. Casting off the confines of a physical sanctuary for a digital cathedral, knowing that church was never a place but a people. Why? Because church. And when my heartbreak becomes too much, caught in that cavernous gap between promise and reality, I testify that every time I muster the courage to keep showing up, I surprise myself that I can find love in broken people and hopeless places. And I find that even my own brokenness doesn't disqualify me when I'm willing to put in the work. And even as certain people grate on me like sandpaper, I feel them wearing down my rough places, granting me much needed lessons in patience and compassion, forgiveness and humanity, giving me the chance to practice being human. Why? Because church. For our churches are like base camps, teams fanning out, forming rapid response networks of prayer and safe passage for all who seek safety, for all who seek self-determination and shelter. We feed each other and are fed. We dismantle the prisons of supremacy living within and around us, all the while growing us awkwardly and lovingly as we navigate the challenges of a mission that calls us to the brink of all that we love and know and invites, and commands us to step out in faith, to commit to be changed, to covenant, to promise to a journey without knowing what intimacy, what vulnerability will be asked of us as we embark. For if we knew, friends, we wouldn't say yes, but when we look back, we can't help but thank God we did. Why? Because church. I have witnessed friendships formed in social halls, sparked in classes that have saved lives. Zoom chats brimming with prayer, heartfelt messages launched not into a void, but as offerings into the heart center of a community that breathes, that conspires both IRL and within and beyond those ones and zeros that constitute our now other gathering place. All of it revealing shards of holiness, reflecting belovedness imperfectly, but truly whispering, you are not alone. You belong beyond your choosing. The story is not over, and we each have a part to play. And though you may not believe it, or feel it moving within you, or trust it enough to let your guard down, what church can do is make love tangible, not simply theoretical, joined together in one body in church. Amen.
Somehow we take it in, moving for the win, shaping change, and new things begin. You are a holy friend.
Before there was anything, there was God, a few angels, and a huge swirling glob of rocks and water with no place to go. The angels asked God, "Why don't you clean up this mess?" So, God collected rocks from the huge swirling glob and put them together in clumps and said, "Some of these clumps of rocks will be planets, and some will be stars, and some of these rocks will be just rocks." Then God collected water from the huge swirling glob and put it together in pools of water and said, "Some of these pools of water will be oceans, and some will be clouds, and some of this water will be just water." Then the angel said, "Well, God, it's neater now, but is it finished?" And God answered, "Nope." So on some of the rocks, God placed growing things and creeping things and things that only God knows what they are. And when God had done all this, the angels asked God, "Is the world finished now?" And God answered, "Nope." God made two humans from some of the water and stardust and said to them, "I'm tired now. Please finish up the world for me. Really, it's almost done." But the humans said, "We can't finish the world alone. You have the plans and we are too little." "You are big enough," God answered them. "But I agree to this. If you keep trying to finish the world, I will be your partner." The humans asked, "What is a partner?" And God answered, "A partner is someone you work with on a big thing that neither of you can do alone. If you have a partner, it means that you can never give up because your partner is depending on you. On the days you think I am not doing enough, and on the days I think you are not doing enough, even on those days, we are still partners, and we must not stop trying to finish the world. That's the deal." And they all agreed to that deal. Then the angels asked God, "Is the world finished yet?" And God answered, "I don't know. Go ask my partners."
It was March 2020. You know the week. I'm sitting in my home office, and just a few feet away from me, my two teenagers are in the living room homeschooling. And a few feet away from them, my partner's at the kitchen table. It is her turn to supervise. Every dividing line that I have carefully practiced in my ministry up until this moment, boundaries that keep my family in one world and my church and work in another, have come undone. Just like everything else I've come to know about what it means to be a minister and do church, all in a matter of days. A pit starts forming in my stomach, and the tears in my eyes feel just a breath away as my body readies itself for grief. I listen to and read every news story I can find as if tea leaves for the future that we will all soon face. With every headline, my stomach grows tighter, and I write letters, and then I make videos to the people in my church and in my family, who, especially those people who in this new world are required to acquiesce. Whether they believe it or not, they are technically over 65 and at risk. For no practical reason at all, I decide I should call Lynn. In the congregation that Sean and I serve, that is the Foothills Unitarian Church in Fort Collins, Colorado, Lynn is one of our elders. Literally, in this case, she's 88. There she is, she's on the left. She's next to two other beloved elders, Bob and Bev. Lynn has been in our congregation for over 50 years. I don't know exactly why I decided to call Lynn, but I just know I need to hear her voice. Lynn is one of many partners I end up calling in those days. I mean, I obviously also call Sean a lot. And then I call Sue and Sarah and Scott and Nancy and Arpie and Johanna and Glenn and Mary and Terry. I could keep going and going and going with my list of names. Who's on your list? Those people you called on in those days, and who call on you. I invite you to just share a few names right now into the space or into the chat, those partners who you count on. In those days, there was this whole web of checking in just called into being, and in every hello, the tender awareness of feeling way too little, like our story. And in every, how are you? The humble surrender of not having any freaking idea about any plans. Except also there was this trust, this automatic response into a steady practice of turning to each other, our partners, who were at least company in the chaos, even though none of us knew when or if the storm would pass. It is, after all, the call that saves us. And the checking in on each other that connects us with something greater, that love that abides. The voice on the other end that says simply yet powerfully, we are still here. We survived. In those days when we had no idea what it would mean for us to do church, at least not as we had known it for decades or even centuries, in those days we knew most clearly how to be the church. We knew to make the calls, we knew to give the money, and we knew to show up in ways that were for more than just ourselves. We also knew we'd need to learn things we'd never known and really never wanted to know. We also knew that we'd have to be okay with being uncomfortable maybe for a long time. The only good news was that at least it would be over by the following May, when the UUA promised that we could get back to normal. Just kidding, Susan. Mostly. Said May. Most of all, in that total disorientation, we knew we needed help, not just from within, but also beyond our congregations. The covenant among our churches was never more alive than in those days, as lay folks and professionals and UUA staff and community ministers and partners in our community, especially the disabled community who had so much to teach us in this time, all of us were in on an ongoing conversation where no one had all the plans, everyone felt too little, and yet we knew we had a big thing worth doing, and our partners are counting on us, and so we could not give up. In those days, we knew instinctively how to be the church, and even more, we knew most clearly why it matters that we are the church. Not perfectly, of course. I had an idea, actually, for a GA workshop where we all could just share our most embarrassing tech messes. That'd be fun, right? For us, I'm pretty sure we'd have to tell about this last Christmas Eve, when literally the feed, it just for some reason that night, it decided it would not load. And then it loaded, and then there was no sound. And then, oh, right, I actually can't even tell you about it because I wasn't there because my family had a COVID exposure 2 days before. Yeah, it was horrible. But in sharing our stories, we would, and we all have our stories, right? But in sharing our stories, we'd remember that neither tech nor perfection are the point. The people are the point. And the partnership with each other and with God, that's something greater, that's, and the deal we make to keep trying, that's the point. And we did it. We are here. We are here. And we survived. Since I started seminary, in 2007, article after article and lecture after lecture has described the institutional and the local church in every way opposite of how I have just described it. I have heard constantly of the church's imminent demise, the death of Sunday school, and/or our inevitable implosion and/or slow drift into oblivion. In seminary, we learned that millennials thought we were irrelevant. Boomers would soon be focusing on their retirement vacations. And the silent generation were aging out out of the heaviest volunteer lifting that we'd relied on them for so long. Now, you may have noticed that in addition to Gen Zers who weren't yet constituted, they left out one generation in this analysis. Which, in my opinion, was a miscalculation, given how many of us Gen Xers are now holding lay and professional leadership in our congregations. To quote Nirvana, "Oh well, whatever, never mind." My point is, long before the pandemic came along, our beloved local congregations, this institution to which many of us have dedicated countless hours, if not our whole lives, have needed what Diana Butler Bass has described as a major reorientation if, quote, we are going to remain relevant in this new world. Long before the pandemic, our families and children were not showing up consistently or at all, and yet needed ministry more than ever.
Already before the pandemic, giving was changing as younger generations have fewer resources and really didn't get this whole idea of pledging anyway. Already, we needed to be fully and fluidly present both online and in person, even though we really had no idea what this even meant. And already, our churches were some of the least progressive, most monocultural, white, hetero spaces that many young people will encounter in their whole lives, despite the story many of us tell ourselves or the call that most of us know our faith makes. Long before the pandemic came, our congregations already needed to change, and they were already at risk. I don't mean, though, at risk of closing, especially those of you in our smaller congregations. You're kind of like that tiny mint plant that I planted in my backyard. It just survives even the heaviest snows. But more, I mean that we were already at risk of forgetting that why that was so clear to us in those early days of the pandemic, and that were also so clear to us in the early days after Trump's election, or in the early days after 9/11, or after George Floyd was murdered, or after the floods took everything, or on any of those days when the bottom drops out from the middle of our lives and we know we cannot do it alone. In those days, the why of church surrounds us and scares us and soothes us all at once as we feel seen and found and held and charged as if for the very first time. This feeling, this ministry is the promise of the local Unitarian Universalist Church, with the not radical, still radical idea that we are all in this life together at its center. And when the crisis comes, we know this promise so well. We feel its urgency and its call, and we instinctively say yes. It's just on the other days, when the crisis fades and we are back in ordinary times, we all too often forget. Or what's more true is that we have our hearts broken enough times that we choose to forget. As Sean said, churches are human enterprises. And to give yourself to a Unitarian Universalist congregation is to say yes to disappointment, or worse. And so we lose faith, we get tired, we stop going, or we keep going resentfully. We shrink our dreams, or grow bitter, or numb, or all of the above, especially in these days. Just a couple of months ago, some of our dearest congregants came to me to say they were feeling disconnected from the church. It wasn't a complaint. It was more like a confession. These are our past board members, our most generous donors. Just a few years ago, they could not have imagined their lives without our congregation. And yet here they were, feeling like they just weren't sure about any of it anymore. And they aren't alone. In the intervening days and weeks and what felt like decades between early 2020 and mid-2022, a lot of us have become familiar with this sense of disconnection. Not just because of the pandemic, with its polarization and politicization and that pit in our stomach that we never had time to tend to, but also because of the rise of white supremacy and fascism as it replied to what many of us believed was progress in creating a truly multicultural, multiracial democracy. And then alongside that, the climate crisis has come in close, which in my area now means we have wildfires in December. And in yours, might mean still trying to recover from the last storm when the next one comes. The combination of all of these collective forces constitute for us a moral injury, a trauma. And yet we are pushed to keep going. We push ourselves to keep going, get back to work, even while death and extinction surround us and threaten us daily. We are encouraged to return to normal as if the last 2.5 years were like a blip in a Marvel movie. We have survived, and also we are not the same. Whatever notions we had of the world being finished, or at least on its way, have come undone. Whatever notions we had of we being the ones to finish it have come undone. In so many ways, our churches, our association, the institutions around us have come undone. There is so much work to do, so much ministry needed, and we are so small, so tired, and so in need of ministry ourselves. Is it finished yet? Can I tell you something? When our president invited me to preach this service, just like Pastor Jacqueline Duhart told us was her first reaction, my first reaction was also no way. Obviously, I did get to the second reaction, which was, oh God, I'm doing this. But that first reaction was real, and it was rooted both in my terror and equally my confusion about what it means to be here with all of you at General Assembly. Now, to be clear, over the years, I've loved much at GA. I have cried and laughed and sung with joy in the rare and powerful experience of being with thousands of other UUs while we are reminded both of who we are and who we are yet called to be. And still, I have also always felt confused about what it means to do Unitarian Universalism in general. Because where Unitarian Universalism has meaning for me is in the particular, in the people and the partners and the stories, even the particular annoyances and frustrations and heartbreak, most of all in the particular repair and the change. Unitarian Universalism comes alive by way of a localized, particular covenant grounded in place, where hearts can be opened and mindsets can shift over years of often hard and even painful ministry to and with the imperfect people who keep showing up. It is like this little button that one of our congregants gave me a few years ago. It said in big letters, "I love people." And then in little letters underneath that, it said, "In theory." The grand ideals of Unitarian Universalism that inspire so many of us to travel across the country or to log on in the middle of our busy lives, this is us loving people. In theory. Here we can connect with the good news of our faith that brought so many of us to our churches in the first place, and yet keep the promise at arm's length, set in bold generalities and sweeping statements of conscience that may or may not have real meaning back in our hometowns and home churches. Which again, this is not unimportant, and after all we have been through, keeping our faith at arm's length is understandable. It's just this. All of this is not the deal we make as Unitarian Universalists. Our deal is not to love people in theory. Our deal is to love them in real life. Our deal is to keep calling that web of check-ins into being, not just when we're feeling the gift of being in this life together, but in the gut punch, in the times when we most feel like everyone around us isn't doing enough or doing it wrong, when it feels like the only best option is to forget right then, by which I mean, of course, right now, our faith invites us to remember how urgently it matters that we show up and be the church, not just for the rest of the world, but for ourselves. Not just for ourselves, but for that something greater. Because without the people being the church, there is no church. And without the local church, there is no Unitarian Universalism. Which means the most important part of our General Assembly, is the way it inspires us to return to our very specific assemblies, our congregations, virtual and IRL, how we will take the inspiration and energy of our theoretical and theological commitments and connect them with the very real life why that we know so well when the crisis hits. And how we stitch all of this onto our hearts so that it pulses with urgency even on the ordinary days or in the days when bitterness is everywhere. In these days, we are called not just to go back to church, but to be the church. And to invite our friends and neighbors to join us as partners, because so much has been lost and so much has come undone, which also means that it must be time to build. It must be time to take all the lessons of who we knew to be in early 2020 and let them inform and drive a new vision where we can meet the no less urgent needs of June 2022 and beyond. I want to offer four examples of this vision. First, in the early pandemic, we loved getting to share Sundays with other UU communities, didn't we? Yeah, it was fun. It's also such a time saver to share ideas and practices so fluidly. And so, rather than just reverting back to old silos in this moment, how about we take this moment to build a movement where collaboration is the norm? Because it is possible we don't actually need 1,000 separate membership committees. Or 1,000 different stewardship committees. Or 1,000 different online services every single Sunday. Example two. In the early pandemic, we knew how critical our local congregations are, how essential they are. And so maybe in our new collaboration, we will build new congregations or plant new campuses, especially in communities hardest hit by COVID, or farthest away from abortion access, or in states currently criminalizing gender-affirming care for our children. How many ministries would we be starting if we decided our congregations matter at least as much as NPR? Or Planned Parenthood? And don't they? Or really, maybe our partnerships will lead us to pay more attention to the UU churches that are already in these communities and follow their lead. I mean, just imagine saying from within your church, dear UU churches in Arkansas and Alabama and Louisiana and Missouri and Wyoming. Now, I know Wyoming pretty well. It's very close to Colorado, so let me pause here to be very specific. Imagine saying from within your congregation, dear friends in Casper and Cheyenne and Laramie, Wyoming, We know that Unitarian Universalism is urgently needed in your communities, and we believe your churches are the best way for our faith to be made real. Thank you for your work on reproductive justice and trans inclusion. Here's some money. Do with it what you need to grow your church. We are praying for you. We are here for you because we are partners, all of us, and we can't give up on this big thing, this deal we make to love people in real life. And yes, that is the Reverend Leslie Key, who serves both in Casper and Laramie, Wyoming. This photo is of her at the abortion clinic that she and her church are starting to help start in Casper right now as a way of fighting the trigger laws in her state. Speaking of money, my third example. Early in the pandemic, we knew that quarantine impacted people differently. Some people lost jobs, some people couldn't get out of their homes, some people were totally fine. And the generosity that I saw during that time was phenomenal in our churches. Suddenly, it's like we understood that giving in our churches could be a radical act of equality and social justice. Or at least it can be when we meet our big dreams with big giving. But this is not the conversation happening in most of our churches right now. We are not talking about building a vision with big dreams. We're talking about cutting it, pulling back on ministry because people have pulled back. But if we are even going to approximate that vision that we have now stitched upon our hearts, then we are going to need to stop spending hours in budget meetings talking about how we can find $200. Or even $2,000. We cannot wait for the church to meet the longing we have and then give. It is our giving that makes that longing a reality. Which brings me to my fourth and final example. In the crisis of 2020, what was clear more than anything was that there are a million places where people today can get great content. What people need more than anything now is great belonging. And the good news that we remembered in 2020 is that this is literally what Unitarian Universalists most have to offer. Our part of finishing the world is the practice of relationships, transformational relationships, accountable relationships, steadfast relationship. And so as we build, let's build up the practices of covenant that help us love each other in real life. Let's learn and teach a different way of checking in with each other. Not just with the people that we already know or who are like us, but beyond that, to ask ourselves who we haven't called, haven't considered, aren't yet in relationship with. And where checking in includes not just offering comfort, but also telling the truth in all its complexities and contradictions, where it includes uncovering where we have failed each other and ourselves. And it includes asking for help and receiving help and praying together, healing, which it sounds sweet, like let's heal, but actually it's really hard and painful. But this is what our covenant actually requires, the hard work of healing in real life, repair, reconciliation, and recovery. In these days of disruption and destruction, we must give thanks that we survived. Our individual and collective survival, it is a miracle. And survival is too small a dream for our big faith. On these days, we must build a bigger dream for our world and for ourselves. We must remember the deal we make as Unitarian Universalists, group by group, congregation by congregation, partner by partner, in these little rooms and these sacred promises. We are big enough. And besides, our partners are counting on us, so we can't give up. Let's keep on finishing the world. Amen.
Have you ever felt like nobody was there? Have you ever felt forgotten in the middle of nowhere? Have you ever felt like you could disappear? Like you could fall and no one would hear?
Oh.
Thank you for being here IRL, which means in real life, and for being on Zoom. I just want to echo what was said about this being a sanctuary and a place of belonging and a place where we're, you know, searching for love and how important it is that this congregation be strong and thrive. We have a lot of work to do. In a moment, we'll be asking the folks on Zoom to unmute for the benediction, and you'll be able to rise in body or in spirit here and share elbows or hold hands, whatever you're most comfortable with. I just want to thank Don and Rob for being our tech gurus, Joe Miller for being here, and for all of you being here. And so now we will say our benediction. Oh, and we'll have lemonade out. Oh, go ahead, stand up. We'll have lemonade outside so you can be refreshed. For those who come seeking God, may God go with you. For those who come embracing life,
may life return your affection. And for those who come to seek a path, may a way be found and the courage to take it step by step. Blessed be.
See you next Sunday. Have a wonderful rest of your weekend. Happy 4th of July. Peace and blessings, everyone.